Hello and welcome to the lecture 3 part A. Elements of the BV geometry, and I added the letter S here for Albert Schwarz. The reason for this is that he actually contributed quite a lot to shaping the notion, so maybe it's a good idea to call it BVS geometry. So let's consider a finite dimensional analog of the BV framework. So assume that F is a finite dimensional version of a space of fields, BV extension of fields and ghosts in some gauge symmetry, gauge theory. So let's just, we can always assume that F is a shifted cotangent bundle of F, where F is some Z-graded supermanifold, for example, with coordinates x, eta, and beta, as we have for the Poisson sigma model, with the grading 0, 0, 1, grading by the ghost numbers, and with the parity even, even, odd. So F is an odd symplectic supermanifold, Z-graded, and symplectic form can be written like this in local Darboux coordinates. So let's consider a Lagrangian submanifold in F. For an odd symplectic manifold, there is a remarkable fact. Half density on F on the total space induces a density on L. This is only for the odd symplectic manifolds. This is not true when omega is an even symplectic structure. In the usual case, it's definitely not true. Okay, so actually there is a nice fact that any Lagrangian submanifold in the odd symplectic manifold, it's isomorphic to a conormal bundle of some submanifold in F. So this is a basic fact for us. This is a very important fact that half densities, I mean, we discussed half densities in the first lecture. So half densities on F, they are densities, they induce densities on Lagrangian submanifold. And another important fact is that on the space of half densities on F, there is a canonical in the sense that it doesn't require any other choices, second order differential operator, odd differential operator with ghost number 1, which is called BV Laplacian. In local Darboux coordinates, it's given by this formula. And remember, locally, half densities are functions. So it acts on half densities as functions in local coordinates in this way. And it's clear that delta squared is zero. It satisfies several other properties. I'm not going to discuss them all now, but you can see some natural identities. For example, if you'll take the product of two functions, act on this product, then you will see that this is delta f. Trying to do something that I don't need really here. So delta fg plus minus f delta g plus minus, because you know f can be even odd and g can be either even odd, so I don't want to keep track of pluses and minuses, plus the Poisson bracket between f and g. And this is the reason for this Poisson bracket correction, is because this is a second order differential operator. This is not a derivation on the algebra of functions. So now the definition of the BV integral. So let nu be half density on f and L be Lagrangian. Lagrangian submanifold in f. So let's define this integral of nu over L. Remember that nu is a half density on f, and that means nu restricted to L is a density. So we can integrate nu over L. And the very important theorem is that this pairing doesn't depend on continuous deformations of L if delta nu is zero. And the second theorem is that, so in other words, if nu is a cocycle for this differential delta, if we integrate a coboundary, then we'll get zero. So the corollary is that if nu is a cochain, then this integral doesn't depend on, it depends only on the class of continuous deformations of L and the cohomology class of nu. So this is the beautiful fact, and we will exploit this fact following the long tradition of BV integration to redefine the path integral in the Poisson sigma model in such a way that it actually can be computed as a formal integral, in the sense that contributions near the critical point can be written explicitly in terms of Feynman diagrams. Okay, so BV path integral and the gauge fixing. So suppose that we want to make sense of the path integral like this. So it may have some complicated gauge symmetry. Because of the gauge symmetry, the integral is not defined. I mean, not that the path integrals are defined anyway. But in this case, even if you will try to define a path integral as a formal integral, you will fail because the critical points are degenerate because of the gauge symmetry. So you cannot use the usual thing about Feynman diagrams. So now just notice that if you know about the BV extensions, then you can see immediately that F is a Lagrangian submanifold in our BV manifold. So this should be F straight. So it's just a zero-section Lagrangian submanifold. So now, let's assume that nu is a half density on F, such that if you restrict it to our Lagrangian submanifold of BRST fields, then we'll have this density d phi with respect to which we define the original integral. So now, suppose that we will succeed defining a functional on the space of fields, BV fields, such that if you restrict it to the original space F straight, we will have the initial action. And the second requirement is that the exponent of this action satisfies the quantum master equation. So here in this quantum master equation, I used a different version of the BV-Laplacian. It's the BV-Laplacian acting on functions on F. This BV-Laplacian is not canonical. You should have an extra data to define this BV-Laplacian, and the extra data is the density mu, which is mu squared. And the definition of this non-canonical BV-Laplacian is the following. If you will act by a canonical BV-Laplacian on half density nu times the function f, you will have this half density nu again times the action of the non-canonical BV-Laplacian on the function f. So that's the definition of our non-canonical Laplacian. So another way to define this Laplacian is just as a divergence of the vector field, Hamiltonian vector field, generated by a function f. And the divergence is understood in the usual sense. If you have a density mu, and then the integral of the divergence of the vector field against some function g is just the lead derivative of this function g integrated with respect to the density mu. Okay, so these are the basic ingredients. Suppose we have all this. So suppose that we have A, our BV action is restricts to the initial action, and it satisfies the quantum master equation. With these assumptions, we can write that our integral is equal to the integral of nu of the function e to the BV action over any Lagrangian L, which is a deformation of f. And, you know, then this integral, the initial integral, is not defined. So you can just hope that you can deform it in such a way that this integral will be defined. And then, since this integral will be defined, you will have some expressions in Feynman diagrams, and then you can see whether this definition is suitable for your needs, and this is how it usually works. So anyway, this may give a reasonable definition if this Lagrangian is a deformation of f, if this is the BV action, and naturally, if the BV action has a simple critical point, non-degenerate critical point on L. So this is the strategy to replace the initial ill-defined integral. By ill-defined, I mean the integral that cannot be defined as a formal integral using the kind of steepest, kind of formal version of steepest descent method, expansion in Feynman diagrams. If we cannot define this, we can try to replace it by this integral and define this integral as a formal integral. Okay, so just a few more remarks. The quantum master equation, you can just take the delta of the exponent, and you will see that it's equivalent to this equation. And you can also see that if as h goes to zero, it becomes the classical master equation. So you can naturally expect that the quantum action that you need here, let me put small letter h here, so you can say that you can look for solutions to this equation in this form. And there are some beautiful results in this. So let's move further. So now BV path integral for the Poisson sigma model. Okay, so as it was outlined above, the what we want to do is we want to transform our integral, not integrable, path integral, into a manageable BV integral. So for this we need first find a quantum BV action, solution to the master equation, then find the Lagrangian with simple critical points of S, BV, and then evaluate the formal integral for each critical point. And this gives the natural candidate for what we should call a path integral in given gauge theory. Okay, so for the Poisson sigma model, the first part was resolved by Cattaneo and Felder. It turns out that for the appropriately defined delta, the classical BV action is annihilated by delta, and that means that, and also, yes, S bracket was itself is zero, so this means that not only the classical master equation holds, but the quantum master equation holds. Now, parts 2 and 3 require the analysis of boundary conditions. The new Lagrangian submanifold, L, it should agree with boundary conditions. So we will discuss it in a moment. And piece of terminology. This Lagrangian submanifold is called the gauge-fixing Lagrangian. So now let's look at Lorentz gauge. So basically we'll follow again this paper by Cattaneo and Felder, and that's the paper on path integral for the Poisson sigma model and Kontsevich's star product. That's the first paper on the subject. So here is the description of this Lagrangian. It's a subspace in the space of BV fields for a disk, where the X dual, B dual are zero, eta dual satisfies this constraint, and D star of eta is also zero. Because the disk is contractible, these constraints on eta dual and eta, they imply that we can represent them both in this way. So we will, in particular, we will use this representation for eta dual. It's easy to check that this subspace is isotropic with respect to omega d. That's actually not completely obvious, but it's easy to check this. And so here's the argument that it is Lagrangian. Of course, it's an infinite dimensional space, so to say exactly what it means Lagrangian requires a little more, but here is the way how you can think about this. So we can decompose the space of one forms into D exact and D star exact. This is Hodge decomposition. I'm skipping some details about which forms exactly should be here. I mean, some of them should be relative to the boundary, but that doesn't matter at the moment. So these circled parts of the decomposition, so this is eta dual, this is eta. So you can see that we crossed out exactly half of this space. So at least at this very superficial level, you can see that it's reasonable to assume that L is Lagrangian. Okay. So, one more clarification. Strictly speaking, because we will define the formal path integral, so in other words, when I write this integral, it means that I'm really integrating over the formal neighborhood of a critical point C for the action S, which means that really I'm integrating over the tangent space at C for the space of BV fields, which means that this is really where the Lagrangian should sit, so I didn't really pay attention to this, but that's how it should be. And again, unfortunately, it's due to time constraint, we have 3 hours of these lectures, and also the kind of weird setting of these lectures as some video pre-recorded lectures, so I'm making some disclaimers instead of the very precise exposition. So okay, so this is about the Lagrangian. So now let's restrict the BV action to our Lagrangian subspace, because then over here we really have S restricted to L, and this is called the gauge fixed BV action. So it has this form in components, or it's even more convenient to write it in terms of super fields x hat and eta hat. I mean, sorry, this should be, so if beta cross and x cross, oops, I'm making mistakes, so this should be, yes, so this should be, we have beta cross here and x cross here, but remember that on this Lagrangian, on the gauge fixing Lagrangian, these fields are zero, so this is the original formula for the BV action in terms of x tilde eta tilde restricted to the submanifold where beta cross is zero and eta and x cross is zero, with the additional constraints like this. Okay, so now it's time to find the critical points and take into account boundary conditions, and so in this next lecture, next part of the lecture, I'll follow to the end the I'll continue the essentially the overview of the paper by Catania and Felder on the Kontsevich star product, and then at the end we will see how it works for transition amplitudes and topological quantum mechanics. So that's the end of the lecture 3A.